So to counter these world interactions, they are giving you a very good, beautiful narration of godly things, super divine instances and episodes. Listen to all of them. After the devotional fondness towards God sufficiently grips your mind, you feel like chanting the name of God yourself. When you start chanting the name of God, Hare Rama Govinda Krishna Murare, Hare Rama Govinda Krishna Murare. You can yourself chant. There are a number of names. We have Sahasraramas for Mahavishnu, similarly for Shiva and other gods and goddesses also. So by chanting it yourself, Tatha Tatha Pashyati Vastu Sukshmam, the effect of listening to godly narrations, divine narrations, and chanting the name of God will be the mind of the reciting person will be purified. To which extent the mind, the internal system gets purified, to that extent he says, Tatha Tatha Pashyati Vastu Sukshmam. The subtle, the supremely subtle truth, Vastu Sukshmam, Tatha Tatha Pashyati. As much as or to the extent the mind gets purified by this kind of a divine exposure and association, to that extent, so much the mind will be able to perceive directly and also realize the Atma. Sri Krishna describes the Atma to be Vastu Sukshmam. It is a Vastu, a kind of a substance or a reality which is extremely subtle, Sukshma. So the Atma is called Sukshma Vastu. The world is called Sthula Vastu. Sthula means gross and Sukshma means subtle. So the subtle self will be perceived by the mind when it becomes pure. And to generate purity, bring about purity, this divine exposure and association are provided. Chakshuryathaiva Anjana Samprayuktam. In olden times, Anjana stone was used to remove cataract from the eyes. So when the eyes, the cataract is removed, how vision is restored? In the same manner, when the mind is made pure, purity is restored to the mind, it will be able to perceive and realize the inmost self very clearly. Yatha yatha atma parimrjyate sau mat punyagatha shravana abhidanai tatha tatha pasyati vastu sukshmam chakshur yathaiva anjana samprayuktam. Shankara has written Viveka Chudamani, about which I often make a reference. Very often I also quote from Viveka Chudamani. It's a very beautiful, sublime spiritual text, the last that Shankara wrote, as you might have heard so many times. He says, you know, here Sri Krishna gives it a devotional touch and a devotional association. Shankara puts it in a totally spiritual and philosophical manner. Though the manners are different, the content and the message are the same. Yatha yatha pratyagavasthitam manaha tatha tatha munjati bahya vasanam nishesha mokshe sati vasananam atmanubhuti pratibandha shunya. He says, in Sri Krishna's statement, the exposure and association to the divine stories of excellences relating to God are the medium to bring about purity. Here he says, take to meditation and allow the mind to dwell in the inmost self. As it is dwelling on the external world and objects, let it start dwelling in the inmost subject. The inmost subject is called the self. Yatha, yatha, in which manner, to the extent, pratyagavasthitam manaha, the mind is withdrawn from the external objects and made to rest upon the inmost self, the I, the subject. Tatha tatha munjati bahya vasanam. To that extent, the mind will automatically abdicate. It will renounce, relinquish bahya vasanam, the desires for external things and possessions. Nishesha mokshe sati vasananam. When all the desires become extinct, they are attenuated, then you will find Atmanubhuti pratibandha shunya. The experience of the self will become free of all obstacles completely, he says. Yatha yatha pratyagavasthitam manaha tatha tatha munjadi bahya vasanam nishesha mokshe sadi vasananam atmanubhuti pratibandha shunya. Now, in Sri Krishna's words and also in Shankaracharya's words, you find the same proposition very much confirmed. Chetomalani vidhamet guna karmajani. By taking unflinchingly, unswervingly to the supreme devotion to the lotus feet of the infallible Lord, when the mind's purities are removed, then the whole thing will become clear. Now, Pipalayana completed his narration and Nimi Chakravarti is raising another question. Karma yogam vadadanaha purusho yena samskritaha vidhuyehashu karmani naishkarmyam vindade param. Pipalayana concluded saying that when the mind's impurities are completely removed and redressed, then the realization of the self will be had. Life's fulfillment will be achieved, he said. So he links up the question to that statement. Karma yogam vadatanaha purusho yena samskrita. You tell us that kind of an activational pursuit, that kind of a discipline, that kind of an orientation, or that kind of a procedure, so to say, by virtue of which karma yogam vadatanaha purusho yena samskrita. Any human being will become cultured, reformed and refined. So in order to reform and refine human life, what is the procedure called for? Let us know very clearly about it. This is the enquiry. Vidheye hashu karmani naishkarmyam vindate param. Now he links up the question saying that vidhuye hashu karmani naishkarmyam vindate param. Karmani ashu vidhuya. While living in this world here itself, how is it possible? What is that karmic procedure, practice, by virtue of which all the karmas can be washed off? The impurities of the mind can be completely removed. Naishkarmyam vindade param. And the human will attain that naishkarmya. That is the message of Srimad Bhagavatam. Naishkarmya. Srimad Bhagavatam Purana Mamalam Yad Vaishnavanam Priyam Yasmin Paramahamsyam Egamamalam Jnanam Param Giyade Tatra Jnana Viraga Bhakti Sahidam Naishkarmyam Avishkrutam Tatra Jnana Viraga Bhakti Sahidam Naishkarmyam Avishkrutam. This is from the concluding portion of Srimad Bhagavatam. Bhagavata itself says, in Srimad Bhagavatam, we are exposing the accomplishment or achievement called Naishkarmya. As opposed to ceaseless activity that we are involved in, we reach a stage where we have no desire and we have no propulsion or need to take up any undertaking or action, religious or secular, in order to achieve a certain goal. We reach a state of Naishkarmya, action freeness. This is what it says. So Nimi Chakravarti puts it very clearly here. Naishkarmyam vindade param, by which we can attain the supreme Naishkarmya after removing all the greed and need for activities and interactions. Karma yogam vadatanaha purusho yena samskritaha vidhuyeha shukarmani naishkarmyam vindade param. Evam prashnam rishin purvam abrucham piduram dige nabruvan brahmana putra tatra karanam uchyatam. In fact, my dear yogis, I raise this question before my father. Nabruvan brahmana putra tatra karanam uchyatam. At that time, I was not given a reply. What is the reason for it? I raised the same question before my father, in front of Sanagadis, and they did not answer me at all. Please let me know why I was refused an answer. Why did they not answer? Shri Avirhotra Uvacha. Now the next yogi to answer King Nimi's question was Avirhotra. Karma karma vikarmedi vedavado nalaugikah vedasya cheshwaratmatvad tatra mukhyam disurayah. Karma karma vikarmedi vedavado nalaugikah vedasya cheshwaratmatvad tatra mukhyam disurayah. You know, Srimad Bhagavata is a great Vedantic exposition. All the elements, all the principles, all the propositions, all the goals, everything described in Vedanta has an expression here. It finds mention here. It is dealt with. Karma karma vikarmeti vedavado nalaukikaha vedasya cha ishwaratmatvadu tatramuhyam disurayaha. It is true that Vedas are a knowledge treasure. And in the knowledge treasure, everything that is discussed is to enlighten the human being. And these Vedas, karma, akarma, vikarma, iti vedavadaha. The Vedas start giving you a lot of do's and don'ts. They are called vidhi and nisheda. Generally, they can be considered to be karma, normal actions which are to be done, which are being done and should be done. Akarma means that which is opposed to action, non-action. Vikarma means things which are forbidden. So karmas which are to be performed and non-action opposed to it, and vikarma, things which are forbidden. Vedavado nalaugikaha. This is actually a theme, purpose and discussion of the Vedas. They are not laugika. They have got a higher and a divine or a supra-worldly meaning and relevance. Vedasya cheshwaratmatvadu. Because the Vedas were evolved and written by people, great thinkers, who had gone above the so-called normal mind. The Vedas are called apaurusheya. What does it mean? Those people who have been able to rise above the normal level of humanhood, they were able to think of and arrive at Vedic propositions. When the mind becomes super pure, it becomes transcendental, then you have an insight into matters in a manner totally different from what others are likely to have. While others are all worldly and secular in their perceptions, evaluations, attitudes, objectives and assessments, the Vedic thinkers were completely supra-worldly. Because it is evolved from God and godliness. Vedasya cha ishwaratmatvadu tatra muhyanti surayaha. Even wise people, knowledgeable people are confused and deluded with regard to a right understanding of Vedic injunctions, Vedic propositions. You were obviously very young at the time. At that time, how can this question be answered in front of a boy? So obviously, because of your lack of growth and maturity, you were not given an answer. Now the Vedas are initially giving you in the Samhita portion a number of praises and hymns, praising the superhuman powers. They are followed very soon by a number of rituals and ceremonies, including big yagas and yajnas. But they did not stop there. They transited to the next stage of mental contemplations. And ultimately they arrived at Upanishadic enquiries, findings and revelations. Now you will find the first portion consisting of Samhitas and Brahmanas, they are the ritual section. The ritual section is completely evaluated and condemned by the Upanishadic section. So people are confused. We are asked to perform such a great ritual. And in the Upanishadic portion they say, Plavahyede adrutha yajna rupaha. These are like leaky boats. When you get into them and start traveling, you will find after some time, water has entered, you will sink, you cannot come back, you cannot go forward also. Now, they are absolutely contradictory. So what are we to do? Should we perform the rituals or disregard them right from the beginning? Can we straight away take a leap to the Upanishads and get the Upanishadic purity and clarity and enlightenment? So people are confused. Agrahotra is using three words, karma, akarma and vikarma. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna speaks about it. While giving an instruction to Arjuna in the battlefield of Kurukshetra, it was not just a small instruction or a concentric instruction. Bhagavad Gita consists of 700 verses. This Uddhava Gita has got more than 1000 verses. In the 700 verses, the whole subject of what? Spirituality, philosophy, yoga and devotion. All of them are discussed by Krishna. So the discussion became very comprehensive. As part of the discussion, he says, Kim karma kim akarmedi kabayopyatra mohitaha karmanohya vibodhavyam bodhavyam cha vigarmana akarmanasya bodhavyam gahana karmanogatihi. My dear viewers, are you with me when I say all these things? We are discussing into the human life, the human personality, the potentials and the possibilities we have in our inner personality, and what shall we do with them, should we do with them, and where are we supposed to reach? These are the intimate questions that we are trying to answer. Kim karma kim akarmedi kavayopyatra mohitaha kavayaha abhi. Very intelligent people, krantadarshis even, are mohitaha, deluded. Deluded about what? Kim karma, kim akarmedi. What is actually the right action? And what is non-action? And what is forbidden action? Kim karma, kim akarmedi, kavayopyatra mohitaha, karmanohyabhi bodhavyam, bodhavyam cha vikarmanaha, akarmanascha bodhavyam. So there also Krishna speaks about three items. What are they? Karma, vikarma and akarma. Actions which are to be done for the benefit of oneself and the society, which will be beneficial in this world, and if there is another world, in that world also. Things which are absolutely different from, opposed to this akarma, and then forbidden actions. All these are to be separately and rightly known. Then he says, Gahana karmanogatihi. The very course and procedure of what is called karmic action and involvement in action, it is something very abstruse and difficult to understand. Here what did he say? Muhyanti atra suraya. This is what Avirhotra says. Even the wise people are deluded about it. Krishna there in Bhagavad Gita says, Gahana karmano gatihi. Therefore, I shall explain to you what is right karma, said Krishna, and explain it. Let us go to the next verse. Parokshavado vedoyam balanam anushasanam karma mokshaya karmani vidhatte hyagadam yata. These are wonderful propositions. I sometimes wish, how many of you will know about this? How many of the people in our country also will know about it? Such a great pronouncement about human activity, its objective, and how the objective can be realized. After all, we are living in this world with a lot of ado. What for? Ultimately, what are we supposed to get? What are we supposed to achieve? Should we not know about it? Everyone is living, so many generations have passed. We do not seem to be doing anything different from what our predecessors have done and said. They also made a dwelling place, they also lived there, they got their children married, they had children, grandchildren. Like that the parampara goes. But we have an intelligence to understand, we have a mind to feel, we have a heart to melt. With all these wonderful possessions that we have, what is ultimately the true human life, the noble human life, the purposeful human life, the meaningful human life? So here he analyzes it. Parokshavado vedoyam. Parokshavado vedoyam. The language and the words, the sentences, statements and pointers presented by the Vedas have an indirect meaning, he says. Pratyaksha means whatever is evident before the senses is pratyaksha. Paroksha means that which will become clear and evident for your intelligence when you think about it. So every Vedic statement, it is not to be literally taken for the meaning of the words they have used. Parokshavada. Why are the Vedas saying so? The Vedas speak about a heaven. Where is this heaven? Somewhere in the universe. When will you go there? After the fall of the body. After the fall of the body, how can we go? What mechanism or faculty do we have? Mind is associated with the body. Intelligence is associated with the body. Ego is also associated with the body. So when the body falls, all these things also go away. Then what is meant by our going to heaven? Even if we go there and we don't have a body and senses, can we see anything there? If we don't have a mind, can we enjoy anything there? These questions are never taken up by people. So why are they saying about heaven? We have to think about it. I am not explaining it now. I have explained it sometime earlier or will do it later. Parokshavado vedoyam balanam anushasanam. Just like we are inducing children to take a medicine which is distasteful, we give them, here is a little jaggery, a little honey. You take this medicine and I will give you this honey. So we are tempting the children to take otherwise a distasteful medicine, a bitter medicine. In the same manner, the purpose of the Vedas by giving you big promises and assurances is to make man noble and listen to what they say. And the Vedic statements do not stop either at Samhita or at Brahmana or at Aranyaka. They have their conclusion in the Upanishads, where everything is explained clearly, well and conclusively. So you cannot stop in the midway. People are stopping because they find a number of flowery promises are there. As Krishna puts it in Bhagavad Gita, Yamimam Pushpitam Vacham Prabhadanti Avipaschita. Because people do not have a discriminating sense. Yamimam Pushpitam Vacham Prabhadanti. They are always making flowery speeches, not fruitful statements. So, Parokshavado Vedoyam Balanam Anushasanam. Huge rewards for mighty, huge performances like Ashwamedha Yaga, Rajasuya Yaga, Soma Yaga, Putrakameshti, etc. So many big and huge rewards are enjoined there. Actually, these rewards are really not there. It's only to make you take up such performances. And when you do such performance, yajna, dana and tapas being the three elements essential in this, your mind is purified and a holiness and piety are absorbed. That is the purpose. In reality, karma mokshaya karmani. How many times shall I say this? Karma mokshaya karmani. All kinds of indulgence and pursuit in activities ultimately is to withdraw from every one of them and make you free of. I have lived enough. I have enjoyed enough. I have seen. I have heard. I have possessed. I no more want anything at all. I have nothing to give anymore to the world, nor take anything from the world. I am full and complete. I am leaving everything. This kind of a redemption you must attain. The whole purpose of action and involvement in action is to take you to an action-free or an actionless state. Vidhatte hyagadam yatha. It is just like wrapping up things. Suppose a medicinal item is to be taken. It is very bitter, very bitter. You will not allow yourself to take it. Then it is covered by something sugar-coated and then you are given this. That is the purpose. Shreyan drivyamayad yajnyad jnana yajnya parantapa sarvam karmakhilam partha jnane parisamapyade.